A very good morning once again and welcome back to The Big Issue. Now, last week, the State Minister for Gender and Culture, Honorable Peace Mutuzo, asked Ugandans to shun paying bride price because it has turned out to be one of the major sources of violence against women. Now, Honorable Mutuzo's remarks comes at a time when Uganda is also participating in the United Nations 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. This is not the first time Uganda is attempting to address excesses in bride price payments. In 2015, the Supreme Court of Uganda upheld that it is unconstitutional for a bride to refund bride price upon dissolution of a customary marriage. This conversation is rather subjective, if not controversial, depending on one's culture, faith, and practices. Now, what is the basis of paying bride price? How do parents arrive at such amounts? Of what importance is bride price in building strong families and strong nations? And what remedies are there to be seen once Ugandans choose to shun paying bride price? My guests this morning are three distinguished gentlemen and also lady. Honorable Peace Mutuzo will be joining us live from her, you know, upcountry home. But before we get to Honorable Peace Mutuzo, we have Nakaliowa Kamel. She's a lawyer at Edroma and Company Advocates. We have Dr. Rashid Rukwago, is a member of the Buganda Luchiko. But also we have Asha Namanya, is a pastor at Rubaga Trinity Church. Thank you so much, lady and gentlemen, for joining me. Dr. Rashid will be joining us during the show also. Let me start with Kamal, because then this has a lot to do with, although it has a lot of faith and culture, but also the law is involved in it. How did the minister arrive at this? And is shunning paying bride price a solution to address his excesses, which are actually seen and also visible in bride price?
Thank you very much, our viewers, for watching. And bride price arises from the different cultures that are in our community as Ugandans, but also depending on the amount that is being. First, I would like to go to the Constitution, because the Constitution gives everyone the right to carry out their culture. Mm-hmm. At that, everyone can contract a customary marriage, and one of the prerequisites for you to fulfill a customary marriage is fulfilling the practices and cultures of the person that you're getting married to. If you're getting married to a woman from, say, a Muganda, you have to carry out that marriage in the practices and ways of Baganda. So that is how the bride price issue will then arise, and the amounts that you might have to pay, the cost of the bride price has to be decided by the family of the what? Of the woman. So if that amount, so in the essence, bride price is actually constitutional. It is constitutional because it is it is a practice according to culture.
Let me before I get to Dr. Rashid, let me bring in Pastor Asha. From the faith point of view, is bride price actually catered for now in the different faith? Also in your faith, what actually does the book, the holy books, talk about bride price?
Okay, thank you very much again for hosting me on this controversial subject. I would say yes, it is, and it is catered for, but I'll give about three contexts. We are only talking about the bride price, but there is also a bride service, and in most cases, and also dowry, because these are three that are different in context.
Yes.
So of course, in our Holy Bible, it is catered for. If you go to even the beginning, the Genesis, I know all of us, we are familiar with our father Abraham. When he wanted to get his son married, he had to get some gifts, give his servant, and then go to the family of Bethel to get a wife for him. But he went with the bride price, expensive gifts. He packed like about five camels with so many expensive gifts. So which means that it is biblical, and it is constitutional by law of God as well. So if God ratifies something, It means that it is very important in the family. Mm-hmm. And the challenge that I see is that when a country is a bit more in apostasy, there is much lack of knowledge, there is a little bit ignorance, and people want to use their opinions so that they want to be justified as the law, or they want to pass it or legislate their opinion. My opinion does not become like a law for each and everyone. We need to follow either the Constitution, we need to follow the Bible. When you read Exodus 22 from 16:17, in fact, it makes it more stringent. The Bible says that if you seduce a woman, and that woman has never been pledged in any marriage and she's a virgin, you are supposed to pay a bride price for that woman. If you seduce her and sleep with her. So meaning, by mere fact, just sleeping or fornicating with someone, the Bible actually, I don't know.
If she's a virgin.
If she's a virgin,
there
yes.
is a condition.
Yes, there is a condition. Mm. If she's a virgin, you are supposed to pay bride price for that young lady. And if the father refuses that, okay, you slept with my girl while she was virgin, I cannot allow you to take this girl. Mm. Now, you're supposed to pay a bride price in equivalent to the virgin. So basically, there is a bride price where you're getting married, and then there is you paying a penalty as sort of a bride price if you slept with someone before they gave them to you.
I'll come back to you, Ashley. Okay. Let me get to Dr. Rashid. Dr. Rashid.
Yes.
This whole conversation looks to be like an attack onto the culture, the norms and traditions of many of the African traditional societies.
Yeah.
What would be your response to a suggestion saying that we should actually shun paying bride price because it has turned out to be one of the major sources of domestic violence and also violence against women?
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank my counterpart. First of all, let me put it clear. Rashid Lukwago, sometimes people nickname. They call me the herbalist.
The herbalist.
Yes. I'm not the one.
You are the member of the Luchiko.
Yes,
of the
exactly. That's why I put
that. Uganda Parliament.
Exactly. Yeah. And I am the head of trainers, Chisakaricha Navagereka.
Yeah.
First of all, I thank you for this topic, and I thank my counterparts for bringing in these ideas. First of all, we need to understand, as my sister and my brother said, we have history. Our grandfathers
did this to position the man, to position the culture, to position the peace. First of all, bride price is not bad. Our grandfathers used it to show the responsibility that you are not taking a basket. You are not taking something which is not important. Mm. Women are respected.
We are respected. And maybe shunning it away doesn't bring that kind of a piece the government or the other institutions do want. What is important is the culture and Bible and other avenues to guide the constitution, not the constitution to guide the culture. Because I know it is somehow, somewhere, not handled well, because some parents are now using it as a wealthy pathway. They want their children to
they
make them rich.
Commercialized.
Exactly. They are like using this chance to get money, to get cars, to get whatever. But if we are guided, if they accept that, maybe it shouldn't be a war. Let parents sit down. That's why long ago parents could sit. The side of a woman, the side of a man, and they sit as elders and discuss the issue that I have a wife, I have a daughter, you have my man. They discussed. But today, even the ladies discuss, before even their parents, they discuss, they tell their fiancés, you, if you want me, my mother said, I want a car. My car. My father said, if you don't bring a flat here, you see my color and brown, I have a degree, I have masters. So it's like you're selling things. We're saying goods. So we just need guidance that what is it? It is love. That's why long ago people could sit down, could trace the history, and in Uganda it is called Omanawani. Who's your friend? Who was your friend? Who can stay with you in docility, in challenges, in happiness, and others? So I think we should know what is the importance of this to show the positionality.
Better for us.
Exactly. That I'm a man. I can look for children. I can look for the rent. I can look for food. So I am a man. Let me pay for this. Say, the different things these women pass through when they are groomed, are being groomed, it's not the same way.
Before I actually come back to Cameroon, Dr. Rashid, we have to agree that actually have been abuses.
Exactly, I agree.
This whole conversation called bride price.
Exactly.
And how should, for example, the minister address this? Because, for example, your cultural institution seems not to have been so much vibrant about this.
Yes.
Except for the Katikla, I saw him saying
exactly
this thing needs to be streamlined.
Yes.
What is the kingdom doing to ensure that this actually practice is not abused?
Exactly. I think we are even like two, four, three months, whatever, the Buganda Luchiko brought some guidelines. I think Buganda is doing a very good job. Today it is training these, MCs. MCs. Mm-hmm. They are guiding them on how to guide the parents before even they lead those functions.
Mm.
I think what is important, the government should benchmark from all cultures. How, what Buganda say, Bunyoro and other places, so that they get a niche where they can start to debate about this. Maybe understand the abuses, that these ones are very difficult. We understand the happiness, whatever the other part.
Mm-hmm.
Then we sit down and we say, where can we clarify? Instead of saying we should remove, we should do this, even they should bring a law that a parent shouldn't just bring some difficulties.
Demands.
Because you want money, because you want a car. You should liaise. In terms of bringing peace, not in liars, in terms of money. So some parents reach the extent of going to homes of those children and they say, you did not bring this, bring my child back, as if somebody is taking it back as a good. So I think the government should just sit down, conceptualize issues with the cultures. Mm. It would be good, but they can't remove it.
Absolutely. Come
yes.
on. Mm. Has the government, or has the state really, not crossing the boundaries, because it's my right to set dowry, for example, or bride price, and how much I want my daughter actually to be taken for.
Mm.
Is this not actually crossing the boundaries and infringing on rights of Ugandans to determine how their daughters or how their sons should be marrying off? And is this something that the government has even gotten into regulating bedroom affairs, because this is something that has been really conducted privately?
I do not think that the government in the essence has already given you the rights to practice your culture. So now it's upon the different members of the leadership groups in the different cultures to start to regulate that. Now you can only ask for bride price up to this number of cows. Because the government now cannot start to interfere in how much you need to ask for, from being bride price from the different cultures. Every culture is different. Mm. The government is not part of every culture, so I think it would make sense if the different cultural groups, the leaders in those cultural groups, start to regulate the different.
This is an attack to the right to exercise my culture. Mm. Certainly, if you come up to say you do not have to ask this amount, and yet actually the person who is interested in my daughter is willing, why should actually government or the state have any problem? And how is this, by the way, related to violence against women?
I think basing on the case that there is the 2015 Mifumi case that was decided by the Supreme Court, the issue, the violence issue. Okay, this is what happened. The women, an NGO of women, went to the court. And they objected to refund
price.
Of bride price. Mm. But also, they had their main issues were they wanted to scrape off the bride price, and then also then the refund of the bride price. So then the court of appeal agreed with them. But then on appeal, the Supreme Court decided that bride price is constitutional, but the refund of the bride price upon divorce is the one that is unconstitutional. So what happens is the fact that then for you to get a divorce, you needed to first refund the bride price. It meant that people would end up remaining in abusive marriages, because their parents have already use the bride price and they cannot refund it.
Mm.
So that's, I think that's where the issue of violence would then come in, because the marriage is not working anymore, but then you cannot leave because your parents cannot afford to give back the bride price. So the fact that the Supreme Court decided that at it's in the Constitution though that at the start of the marriage and at the dissolution of the marriage, both parties should have equal rights. So if you've given bride price and it's a precondition for me to refund it before I get the divorce, that means that my rights at dissolution are not equal with those of the gentleman that I'm getting married to. So that means that there may be issues in respect to during the marriage.
Mm.
One is always going to be looked at as the maybe a slave. Mm. Also depending on the holes in the pockets that you leave in some in the husband's, you know, pockets.
Mm.
At the point of marriage. So that means that there may be some tension.
Mm.
Yes.
Pastor Asha, I wanted actually to bring you also on that. Before I do that, how do these families, before I actually get to that question, we are in a free market economy.
Mm-hmm.
I have a right to ask what I deserve,
okay.
And you have a right to either pay or not to pay. Where should people actually have a problem for 30 cows and you can't afford? Why is it so hard for you to go and look for a woman or a lady who is actually worth 2 cows that you have?
Okay, I think you have a point in what you're saying.
Mm.
Because actually love that does not have any value attached to it is senseless.
Mm-hmm.
Like if
Pastor, you're too commercial.
No, if I say
mm.
I really love you
mm.
and I want to get married to you and I want to take you for free, I don't love you. That's what it means. Like there is no value. I'm not seeing any value in you.
Mm.
So basically, the family of the bride need to sit down, evaluate, because honestly, parents go through a lot.
Mm.
They
in
pay
raising
for their children.
Up
yeah, in raising it. I have my 2 girls. I mean, I have to pay school fees, I have to pamper them. By the level they reach the university and all that, you see the cost that has been involved.
Mm.
So you don't expect to come or to bring your boy to my home
empty-handed.
Empty-handed and say, I love you, girl, I want to take. You know, it won't work.
Mm.
It shows that this person is irresponsible.
Exactly.
In fact, the challenge is that the bride price, they are looking at it in a way of commercializing. It's not commercial. It's appreciation towards the raising of this child and how you found them.
Mm. Yeah.
The perspective of the society is the one that is wrong, but it does not make bride price wrong.
Mm.
So I would agree with your with what you're suggesting. If you went to a supermarket, I would suggest if you went to a supermarket and you find the price is a little bit higher,
mm-hmm.
you go to where you belong. You get the point.
Mm.
You say, let me go to Nakasero because I know I'll get plenty at 500 shillings.
Mm.
But you know, an orange at Capital Shoppers, it is going to be about 5,000.
Yes.
You get the point.
Mm.
So it's one, you need to do background check about the family. If you're really interested in marrying me or marrying my daughter, one, check who is the father of this daughter.
Mm.
What is their family background?
Mm.
What is their stakes in this? Because
what is
every
their
culture,
social status?
Yeah, what is their social status
in the society?
Yeah, before, like they used to say that you touch where you can reach.
Yes.
Like if the mango is very far off from you, don't start getting chaya, put the table so that you get that mango.
Mm.
So in most cases, I think we get things wrong. In Ankole culture, there is a Choli culture, so everyone have got their right to determine how they can, you know, evaluate their daughter in being given out in marriage.
Let me bring in Dr. Rashid.
Yes.
What is the basis, for example, of paying
mm.
bride price, and what significance does it have in building strong families coming from the Buganda culture?
Actually, in the Buganda Kingdom, we trace our peace from home. That's why Kabaka comes from Amaka.
Mm.
That our judges could judge, as my brother said, could judge this, that two families, if they born together, after total agreement, mutual agreement,
mm.
both sides groom their children. Because if you come at my home, I become your father. So meaning the significance is peace. Because this bride's price is positioning this man to make him understand that a home is not an either thing, but it's a very either thing if you know what to do. So I think what is important, as he elaborated, to ask the government to sensitize. Let's go back to our cultures. I'm taking there, although we are in modernization, whatever, but we can go back. Government can inject in money, and these cultures teach their communities on how to go back to our. There are certain things. Today, students study at the universities, they sit down, they make their programs, even the function, even they decide the bride price on the table here. They just go and tell their parents that we have finished it. He said he has this. But long ago, they could even bargain. That, no, I think, Msajja Mukuru, let's do this. Yes. Let's do this. I have this. Then
so you negotiate bride price.
Exactly. Sometimes, if others could give away their children without even those strong things, they promised to us.
Somebody was telling me that actually the Honorable Minister may be confusing the gifts.
Exactly.
That we are seeing in these Kwanjula things and the introduction ceremonies with bride price. Where is the difference?
Actually, before answering that, there is a problem. People borrow cars because they want the communities to respect, to say, you know, they compete. Today, the children compete.
Yes.
They say, the other one brought earlier. Today, I'm bringing a base. They go, they hire it, and maybe even during that very function, the owner may come and say, time is over, can you bring my car? Because the mutual cultural perspectives are undermined. So I think my brother, my sister, let's just understand this, that the main solution for this is to go back to our history, to understand what did our fathers do to bring the peace, to create that harmony. So I think there is no way government can enter in this without consulting.
Absolutely. Yes. Kamal, why would one get offended if, for example, I am having a girl that I want to marry, and certainly I can pay for what they have asked for? This is just bride price. I love this girl. I have the capacity to pay. Why should government come and say it's illegal? And why should we even ban it, for example? If I cannot afford it, I can go another person. And should actually we apply law in each and everything, for example, in cultures, in faith? Some of these things are already self-regulated. But then I'll have your comments after this very short commercial break. We are discussing the suggestion from the whether we should shun away with paying bride price. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are discussing actually the minister's suggestion to shun bride price. Before actually we continue, let's first take a look at what the minister was saying and we understand where she's coming from.
In 2015, Uganda Supreme Court ruled against the practice of refunding bride price on the dissolution of a customary marriage, dubbing it unconstitutional. The judges noted that the practice suggested that women were in a marketplace and infringed on their right to divorce. As Uganda joins the world to mark the 16 days of activism campaign against violence on women and girls, the Minister of State for Gender, Peace Mutuzo, has expressed a need for a total ban of bride price in Uganda as a measure to mitigate gender-based violence.
My view, bride price should be out of our way completely. That cultural practice is archaic. It is one of the ways in which people are selling off others. We used to condemn slave trade, but now this is another slave trade. You are selling off your own daughter, your own blood, unknowingly.
Mutuzo says parents have commercialized bride price as a profitable venture to fetch them wealth at the cost of rights of their young girls, hence worsening the child marriage phenomena.
The total sale, a big transaction, commercial transaction. And we think if we remove the bride price, to begin with, how can you attach a price to a bride? That means it is a commercial commodity. A human being is not bought and therefore should not be sold. And it has also discouraged many young people who should have been freely in love from moving forward to legitimate their relationships.
The gender minister noted that many women have become victims of circumstances and have decided to stay in abusive marriages because they don't have money to pay back the bride price. She called upon culture chiefs to review this custom for the better being of the girl child.
On occasions now, we see people paying dowry in form of cars. A car from Japan, how did it become part of our customs and traditions? Fourth, it is removing or denying the potential of girls to be actualized in terms of education, in terms of growth, the brain to grow, to be able to mature up.
Mutuzo, who represents Bunyangabu District as a woman MP, wants the public to join government to enforce the 2015 Supreme Court ruling against bride price in order to create a peaceful environment for women and girls.
Pronouncements are parts of our laws, and it only requires enforcement. Because by the time court processes such a pronouncement, it means it has been able to investigate deeply and has realized that this is a menace and it is not lawful, and they realize it is wrong. So it is our responsibility, me and you, and duty bearers. Talk about teachers, talk about parents, talk about religious institutions, talk about traditional and cultural institutions. All these have been playing a hand in enforcing some of these cultural practices.
Report compiled by Fred Kajubi for the news.
Thank you, Fred, for that report. We are discussing this whole story. Asha Namanya is a pastor at Rubaga Trinity Church. Dr. Rashid Rukwago is a member of the prestigious Buganda Luchiko, and also Nakali Wakamel. She's a lawyer at Edroma and Company Advocates. Let me start with you, Kamel, to react on that. But actually, you have to tie it with the issue of, seems like we are surrendering our cultures to the altar of foreign cultures, Western beliefs. We are now trying to interpret our culture using actually foreign laws. Are we not actually going on a very dangerous terrain and path?
I do not see how we are interpreting the cultures using foreign laws, because our law, which is the Constitution of the Republic of Uganda, which is the supreme law, allows you to practice your culture, and that's all about it. It cannot now help you enforce, it cannot help you amend. Like, you have to practice your culture and you have a right to do so. So in doing so, like, I think the main issue should be how, to what extent, and what should be the threshold, which is very difficult to determine by law.
Because everybody is different.
Yes, and all the cultures are different. So then that means that it's the people, us, who are practicing those cultures that need to be reasonable. If at the age of 30, you
reasonable?
As the father of
what
the,
is reasonable?
What is reasonable is this. This is what is reasonable. If at the age of 30, you as the father of this girl, you could not afford 50 cows, why are you asking 50 cows from a 30-year-old son, of someone else's son?
But we are living in different times.
Even your daughter, the one you're giving, she cannot afford 50 cows at the age of 30. Why are you asking 50 cows from someone else's son at the age of 30? I think that should be the threshold. That should be the test. Mm. If your daughter cannot afford 50 cows, then do not ask 50 cows from a 30-year-old. Even you at 30 years, you did not have 50 cows.
Absolutely. But Asha, I just want to get your view on this, because certainly many people view this whole conversation using Western feelings, Western cultures, and forgetting actually where we are coming from. Because if you want to address such such issues, there are clear channels and there are clear institutions which are actually custodian of our cultures and these practices. What's wrong with actually bringing the ministers and then the lawyers? This is the direction we want to take. And why should even somebody get a problem looking at people taking all sorts of gifts? Somebody's interested in taking a car to somebody's house. What would be your problem? If he gets into trouble, that's his problem.
Yeah, I think maybe the only challenge I'm seeing here is one, is that, everyone think their opinion should work as law.
Mm.
You see, if you are facing a challenge, if you have a family issue with your people in the village, don't bring it at a national level. You find like in different cultures, or maybe there are dilemmas, of course, the challenge is there, but it shouldn't be based on to bias what is good. Like, bride price is not a bad thing, and it does not enslave anyone, and it was not purposed to enslave anyone. It's except that maybe people having that mountain of ignorance towards bride price and the approach they have is different.
Mm.
That's where we're having a challenge. But according to me, I would think we shouldn't apply international or foreign cultures. And I know many Ugandans, these honorable ministers, actually, they just travel abroad. They,
yes.
They see how things are happening.
Because the Bazungu, most times when they go to do this kind of ceremony.
Yes, they do.
And it becomes easy. Yeah, you find their weddings, one or two, three people. Yeah. They're having a wedding. And then somebody says, I want to have like a Mzungu.
Yeah.
My friend, you're not a Mzungu.
That's how they decided. Like they, for them, they sat as parents and families and agreed, this is how we should take it on.
And I have seen weddings, for example, people inviting people to come to the wedding and they ask them to pay for what they are going to eat.
So yes, that's not our culture. It's not our culture. In fact, our culture was to call the community,
yes.
Celebrate. Me, while actually I was growing up, I grew up in the village, I think, for about 11 years, about 10 years. But in our village, when a bride was being taken, it was a celebration in the whole village.
Mm.
They would invite everybody. But they were celebrating not because they are selling this girl, but they feel like there is that she's going to find joy in the marriage. She has joined another family. Now, the challenge is coming from people who visit these countries and watching the operas around.
Yes.
So what they see in the movies is
they want to apply.
For me, I think the Honorable Minister needs to think like, not every law or everything that you find abroad will work for Uganda or work for any other African culture and society. I would think the government should, one, consult the church.
Uh-huh.
That is number one.
The mosque and the church.
Yeah, the church, and look at the faith and how God sees it. You see, the challenge is that we have a motto for God and my country, but we have never even based on our law, based using God. We always look at our opinions.
Mm.
But the motto says, in anything that we must look at, let's first see what is God saying about this.
The minister is talking actually about that this bride price has been abused, that most of the parents would actually, it seems like they are trading or they are selling their daughters. But also there are women who are actually turned out to abuse their husbands because they have not, or their spouses, because they have not paid bride price.
So it's
how do we address that?
Now, in fact, that's a very good debate. You see, your recklessness on how you live in your family does not make the bride price wrong. You get the point? So if you have a point of weakness and you misperceive the bride price, it shouldn't be a benchmark for other families. Because I know that there are other families whereby they have paid bride price and they are very okay. I paid bride price for my beautiful wife.
Yes.
And I shouldn't use it as slave, but I see her.
I imagine the pain you went through.
Yes, I paid about almost coming to 10 cows, 8 cows plus others. But you see, it gives me pride. Every time I look at her, I say, yes, you deserved it. You get the point.
Mm.
So I think the abuse is because people are lacking education about what they are doing. So, and it shouldn't be based on, or the Honorable Minister should not see it. If it has happened in many cultures, yes, let's go and consult the cultural leaders, go and consult maybe the leaders in that area, address it and educate them. I think Hazi has been suggesting, let's have like a sensitization, but we shouldn't make something which is one originates from God, because bride price is originating from God. If I've told you Exodus 22, 16, 17, Deuteronomy 22, 28, 29, it talks about bride price. And I've even shown you that Abraham was appreciating the family where he was getting a wife. And this is our forefather of faith. So to me, I believe that when you love someone, you there is that, they say love rejoices with the truth, love sacrifices. So what kind of sacrifice are you going to give this person? So I believe that with your love, with everything, we cannot eat the love. You get the point? But love can create a lot of things within us. And I was thinking maybe another thing they should consider, the parents, or maybe these families where they are getting the bride or the groom, they shouldn't make the process very hard, you see? They should evaluate and see, okay, we appreciate, but this is the way to go. And let the parents talk. But nowadays, as you were saying, you find a girl and a boy, they met in Kampala at campus.
And they have agreed.
The parent does not know. Yes. The parent spent his money. He sent the child to the campus. They divert from there. They get a boy. They decide. And then they come and say, you know, daddy, this is what we have agreed. You see, that already it is undermining the parent. And I think it is wrong.
Absolutely. Carmen, before I go back to doctor, because I want to end up with him, what remedies and what benefits should we actually get in case the minister's suggestion is adopted? Or, for example, we ban bride price. What type of, what advantages are we likely to get as a country? Or are we not actually going to break the principle values of our families?
I do not foresee a time when bride price is going to be banned. And I cannot even foresee. It's impossible for that part, because this is culture. The only thing that needs to be regulated again is the intensity, is the...
The amounts.
Yes, the amounts that are very aggressive.
To put, how do they call it? The workers' union usually have these minimum wages. So you want to put a minimum bride price.
It's impossible to put that, because also some people, like you said, could afford more. But my issue is in respect to how have you weighed, when after they get married, what are they going to eat? Because for you, you wanted 50 cows, then they're going to eat posho and beans for the rest of their lives. Like, I do not see a time when bride price is actually going to...
It's going to be banned. Yeah. Dr. Rashid,
yeah,
we have to wind up this whole conversation. Assuming bride price is banned, as suggested by the minister, what are we likely to lose out as a country from the perspective of Buganda culture?
I think if we make it away, if we remove it, that is promoting prostitutionism. Because everybody will be taking, as if taking a chocolate, taking that. That is what we call total prostitutionism. So I think I advise the minister to help us understand two things. Culture and religion cannot be tackled anyhow. There are things which are very dangerous to tackle, to
delicate.
Very delicate, very delicate. Two things. I know. I know why I'm a Muganda. Why you are Munyankole?
Yes.
Why you are Anacholi? There is something. Religious leaders have guidance. The Quran has its own way in terms of describing bride price. The Bible and other things. There is no way you can even put the price that everybody...
This is the limit.
You can't. Let the cultures guide. Let the leaders guide. Because, you see, the reason why these parents do want this bride price, even to show their legacy, to show the journey.
Their effort,
the journey of grooming children. So you don't just say, we are bringing guidance. Because one day, also Minister brought in as a suggestion, I cannot enter into that, but it brought some...
She wanted to ban pulling. I didn't know it was that important.
Right, we'll bring another topic one day. My grandmother said, in Uganda, you get up. So, there are things you can't even remove. But what I say, maybe what is important, I agree that many people are misbehaving in terms of describing bride price, but we just need the guidance. We just need to sensitize.
But you have not, as the Buganda, Luchiko, because I know you are the supreme
body
of, for example, culture in Buganda.
Yes.
Why don't you come up with regulations and say, this is how a proper kwanjula, for example, should be?
Even books have been written. Books have been written. Actually, we are doing something. Today, we are training even MCs. We are training them. We want them to first interact with the parents before even the function, to discuss, dialogue about what has been taken, what would, so that we bring peace. Actually, we are starting it. I am the head of, I represent in Kobazambogo, the Buganda Regulatory Chief. Today, we are preparing a vioto, fireplace, fire education in all universities before students go out after completion of their degrees, to tell them about the marriage. Actually, government should also understand this, the informal part. Not only formal degree, they bring in informal perspective. These cultural leaders should visit the universities. Even if somebody doesn't have a degree, there are many actually students in Makerere, a Bagana student there. They sit with them before even they go, because by that time they have interaction, they have their spouses and whatever, so that they understand before they decide for the marriage.
Absolutely.
I think it will bring peace.
Absolutely. Yes. Pastor, actually, one word in just 30 seconds.
I think
there is an issue of dishonest on the part of especially men. You portray a picture of being rich in your in-laws. What do you expect them to actually do?
Now, I think that is wrong. Men shouldn't show a picture of who they are not. Yeah, and it is coming in this generation. You want to show the girl's parents that you're okay, because maybe you want to put that particular picture that, and sometimes it is brought by the girls.
Yes.
They tell my parent is like this, my parent is a professor, so you need to show that image. And sometimes these boys go and borrow big cars and bring them. Then they visit the family, and the professor thinks this man is doing well, and so it brings that dishonest. I think it is wrong.
Yes.
But maybe my final comments would be, the government shouldn't just base the law based on the minister's opinion. That's our opinion. They should visit the culture. They should visit the church, the religious leaders, to guide on this, so that we can have peace in everything that we are making.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, actually, for joining me. Asha Namanya is a pastor from Rubaga Trinity Church,
Christian Church.
Nakariwa Kamel is a lawyer at Drone and Company, advocate Dr. Rashid Rukwago, a member of the great Buganda Luchiko. Thank you so much, gentlemen and lady, for joining me this morning. We've been discussing, actually, the comments coming in from the Minister of Gender and Culture regarding banning of bride price in Uganda. Now, that has been the conversation. But before we take a short break,